Now that we have solved for the rate law for our practice equation, the last two steps to solve for are to find the rate constant, which has units, and then to determine the value for another trial using different concentrations. So notice trial number five, we're given concentrations of reactants and we want to be able to solve for the initial rate. Before we solve for the rate constant, one other helpful piece of information that we can identify is what's called the overall order of a reaction. To do this, we simply add up the exponents. So in our example here, of course, remember that bromide was first order, bromate was calculated as second order, and hydrogen, of course, was zero order for a third order overall reaction. In the next topic that we talk about, knowing the overall order of a reaction will be helpful for determining the equations to use. This can also be helpful in verifying the units that we get for our rate constant. To solve our rate constant, we can use our rate law as a mathematical equation. So remember, the lowercase k is our rate constant. If I want to isolate that, I would divide my rate by my concentrations and orders of reactants. I always recommend writing this setup, even if you don't mathematically need to see it like this, partly because one of the common mistakes I see is students forgetting to raise an exponent to its order, specifically if something is squared. So it's helpful to write this mostly as a reminder to include those exponents. Now, because this is a rate constant and is constant at a given temperature, we can use any of our four known trials to solve for it. And in fact, I encourage you to use all four and confirm that you get the same value of K. I am going to randomly pick trial number three. Again, you can pick any one of our trials from our previous data table. So again, from this table, I'm going to pick our values from trial three. I'm also going to include my units in my setup. Because the units of our rate constant can change, it's helpful to identify what they're going to be for this specific scenario. And so bromide is 0.30 molar, and that's first order, so I don't need an exponent here. My bromate is 0.10 molar squared. And another thing to note is to pay attention to order of operations. In the denominator, make sure if you're entering this all at once that you open and close your parentheses around this product. And so as you plug these numbers into your calculator, you will get a value of 120. Notice that that is correct for sig figs. Every value in this setup has two, and 120 counts as two sig figs. Now, to determine the units of this, I'm actually going to set this up just with units. So my rate has units of molarity per second. In the denominator, my total value for molarity is cubed. And notice that the shortcut version is, because this is third order overall, as we determined here, that is my exponent on molarity. Since I'm working with fractions, I'm going to make my denominator a fraction, and then remember that dividing by a fraction is the same as multiplying by the reciprocal. So the setup that I'm solving now is in this box. Of course, my molarity on top cancels. My molarity on the bottom reduces down to 2. And so my units for K here will be 1 over molarity squared times seconds. And then also remember that units that are in the denominator can be rewritten with a negative exponent. So I can rewrite these units as m to the negative 2, s to the negative 1. That is exactly equivalent. Either version of units is allowed, whatever your preference. They mean the exact same thing, so either option is allowed. Now that we have solved for our rate constant, we can write our overall rate law. That means we include our value and units of our rate constant with our reactants and their orders. And so our overall rate law now looks like this. Again, our rate constant is included, reactants and their orders. And of course, you have the option of including the H plus raised to the zero order if you want. And so that brings us to the very last thing that we can calculate here, and that is to find the rate of trial number 5. So here I've rewritten our overall rate law. We go back to our table to look at our values for trial 5. So again, realize we don't need to include the hydrogen because it's zero order. And so technically I'm just using bromide and bromate concentrations. And before I plug those in, I like to estimate my values. So notice that the concentration of bromide is higher than any other trial. My concentration of bromate is also higher than any other trial. Since my concentrations are higher, I expect my initial rate to be higher than any of the values for trials 1 through 4. Always good to estimate your values before you calculate so that you can see that your answer makes sense. Oh, just kidding. Sorry about that. The other awesome thing about including the units with your rate constant is when we plug everything in, we should get units of just molarity per seconds for rate. And so if you've plugged in the wrong units here, you won't get molarity per seconds, and that allows you to actually go back and check your numbers. And I forgot we changed numbers there, sorry. So the 0.40 for bromide, the 0.040 for bromate. And again, remember, bromate gets squared. That's the both the quantity and the units that get squared here. And when we plug all of this in, we should get a final rate of 0.0. We're going to go to 2 sig figs because of all of our values in here, 0.077. Notice with our 2 reactants, we again end up with molarity cubed, which is going to cancel out that -2 and leave us with 1. So we do have units of molarity per second. And so now we have an equation that allows us to calculate the rate of reaction for any given concentration values of our reactants. The last few slides that I have in here are notes and reminders. So a summary of rate laws, important things to know and remember. So again, a rate law is a mathematical equation that is always defined just in terms of reactant concentrations. The exponents for each reactant have to be determined from a table of experimental data. The orders of reactants can be any combination. So in our example, I specifically chose them to be a 0, 1, and 2, so you could see how those would solve out. But for reactants, there is no relationship between one reactant order and another. They could all be 1s, they could all be 2s, they can vary. They don't all have to be the same. One is not dependent on the other, for example. And again, we find the orders by comparing how concentrations of reactants affect the rate of reaction. And once we solve for our rate constant, we can then use our rate law to calculate the rate of reaction for any combination of concentrations. The last few slides that I'll leave you with in here are extra practice slides. So again, you're given a balanced equation, table of data, and asked to solve for the rate law and rate constant for each one. As always, I recommend that you practice these without looking at the answer so that you can determine that you're on the right track. And then our third one, and again, we have extra examples from our textbook online for extra practice and solutions if you need extra help. And that concludes our information on rate laws.